Okay, good evening. My name is Sharon Suzuki, and I'm the president of Maui Electric Company. Welcome, and thank you for coming here tonight to our Integrated Resource Planning public meeting. Integrated resource planning is the process that the electric utilities go through to determine the future resources to meet the future demand for electricity. And we're here tonight to really get your input, get your feedback on what are some of the ideas that you have in terms of resources that make sense for the Molokai community. We really are here to listen and gather your input, and we'll be putting together an action plan and come back in the April-May timeframe of next year to also get your input on that draft plan. So there'll be other opportunities for you to comment. At this time, I'd like to take the and the process is overseen by the Hawaii Public Utilities Commission. And the commission has hired an independent entity. And I'd like to introduce Carl Friedman back there. Carl, can you stand, please? Can you join me in giving him a hand? So Carl represents the Public Utilities Commission and oversees the process to make sure that we gather objective input across the different companies' service territories. So that's for Hawaiian Electric, our parent company on Oahu, and our sister company, Hawaii Electric Light Company, on the Big Island. We also have a 68-member IRP advisory group, and we have four members who represent Molokai, and I'd like to recognize two that are here tonight. So first is Karen Holt. Karen, back there. Thank you, Karen, for serving and representing Molokai's perspective with the advisory group. And Greg Kahn. Greg, can you stand up? Thank you, Greg, for your time in representing Molokai also at the advisory group. And we also have John Itamura. John, can you stand back there? John is with the Division of Consumer Advocacy, or we refer to them as the Consumer Advocate's Office, on the State of Hawaii Department of Commerce and Consumer Affairs. So thank you, John, for joining us tonight. At this time, I'd like to turn the program over to Anel Amaral, who is gonna facilitate tonight's discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sharon. I appreciate that. Aloha, hiahi kākou, aloha mai. Aloha. Aloha. Thank you all very much for coming this evening. I am the facilitator, and a facilitator is different from a moderator. My function here is to assure that all of our voices are heard, to create an environment where we feel comfortable to be able to share with one another. So at the core of a facilitated discussion is the acceptance that we will all speak respectfully to one another, that we won't interrupt each other, that we leave ourselves open to hearing what others have to say. Even if we may disagree with what they have to say, we leave open the opportunity to learn from one another. It's possible to disagree without being disagreeable. So that's what I'm watching for. The other thing I'm watching for, after the presentation, and I'll start calling on you to ask if you want to speak. So all you have to do is raise your hand and identify yourself. We're going to be recording what it is you're saying. We're going to sort of summarize what you're saying here on these flip charts, and also Therese will be taking notes on the computer. Keep in mind that the people that are doing these recordings are not trained recorders. They are MECO employees, so be patient with them. We don't mind that they misspell things, and we don't expect to get everything that you have to say down, but we'll try to capture and summarize what it is you have to say. We will then take these comments and the comments that have been caught on the computer, as well as those things that you may submit on the comment cards. And we will post them on the website that we will be showing you later. So that everyone going to the website will be able to know what it is Molokai thinks, what it is Lanai thinks, by reading through the comments as they are divided by each of our meetings. The other thing you'll notice I'll do is you'll put your hand up very nicely, waiting for me to call on you. But what I'm also looking for is to try to get everyone to be able to speak at least once before I'll come back to you perhaps and allow you to speak a second time. That way no one voice dominates here and all of the voices can be heard. But I will come back to you eventually, I promise. All right, then I think all that being said, I'm going to turn the program over to Matt. Matt is going to do a PowerPoint presentation. He talks for about 15 minutes. What I'm going to ask you is if, as he's talking, you get confused by something he says or you have a thought, just jot a note down. But let's allow Matt to get through the presentation, and then if you have questions afterwards, we'll deal with it when he's pow. Okay? So Matt, here you go. Aloha.
Thanks, Anel. Okay, my name is Matt McNeff, and I'm the manager of the Renewable Energy Services Department at Maui Electric. The Renewable Energy Services Department is the department that the planning process, or the Integrated Resource Planning Process, IRP for short, falls under. So again, as Sharon mentioned, the IRP process is the planning process the utility goes through. Is that better? Okay.
Can you spell your last name?
Sure. M-C-N-E-F-F, like Frank.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay, so the IRP process is the planning process the utility goes through in order to meet the future energy needs for Maui County. The IRP process is cyclical. Our last one was done in 2007. This one is planned to be completed in 2013. And thereafter, we're gonna do it every 3 years. So again, as was mentioned, in addition to verbal comments tonight or filling out the comment cards that are back on the registration desk, you can also submit comments to the IRP website. That's irpie.com, and you can submit the comments to public at irpie.com. There's some additional signage on the doors there regarding how to submit the comments. And again, as Anel said, you'll be able to see all the comments from tonight, as well as the comments that were gathered from the public meetings on the IRP process for other islands as well. The comment period for this phase of the planning process will be open until December 21st. So the goal of the IRP process, again, is to meet the future and to plan to meet the future energy needs for Hawaii. So we start with scenarios, and scenarios are sort of a range of possible circumstances that represent the future. We don't try to predict exactly what the future is. We come up with sort of multiple plausible futures and try to design around those different scenarios. And those become the basis for the resource plan. And of course, we want to plan to, you know, obviously reliable power, reasonable costs, all those things are incorporated into the planning process. So from the scenarios, we develop a resource plan. And how are we going to meet the energy needs or the different resources that we're going to use to do so over the next 20 years. So the resource plan kind of covers a 20-year planning horizon. And then from that, the final product of the IRP process is the action plan. And that covers 5 years. That's the actions that need to be taken in the next 5 years and the schedule by which we're going to take those actions to meet those energy needs. So what does this all mean? It means we need to come up with plans that balance reliability, renewable energy, and cost. We need to come up with a plan that makes sense in the short term and in the long term, and that takes in input from the community and cultural values. So along with the advisory group, the 68-member advisory group that Sharon mentioned, we've come up with these seven IRP objectives in no particular order. I won't read them all, but generally it's to protect Hawaii's culture, community, environment, to decrease dependence on fossil fuels, to increase use of local renewable energy, and of course, to maintain reliability and do it all at a reasonable cost. As far as the schedule for the whole IRP process, it began in March 2012. The advisory group was formed on June 29th, 2012, and from that point we have 1 year to come up with the final report, including the action plan for the IRP. Right now we're in the first phase of public commenting period. We're having a series of meetings between November 27th and December 13th. Again, comments for this period will be accepted until December 21st. And then there's another round of public comments that will be in the April-May timeframe, and that will be on the draft action plan. So that at that point, we'll be seeking input to our draft action plan. That's kind of the final output of the IRP process. And again, so it'll be concluded when we submit the report in June 2013. So just a little bit on what scenario planning is. I kind of mentioned it previously, but we don't try to predict exactly what the future is going to be, what oil prices is going to be, what the demand will be. We come up with multiple different scenarios that, you know, represent a range of possible futures. And we try to plan around the similarities or differences between those different scenarios. So here are the four scenarios that were developed as part of this IRP process. And these scenarios are discussed in more detail in your guys' handouts tonight. Or if you're interested, there's even more detail on the IRP website. So I won't go into all of it, but just generally, you know, the four scenarios are plotted against the two key drivers, that being the price of oil and public policy on renewable energy. And just for example, the blazing a bold frontier scenario represents a world where the public policy on renewables is very high and the price of oil is also very high. So that sort of represents a pull out all stops towards getting off fossil fuels type scenario. And so in the next part of the presentation, I'm just going to present a couple different generation technologies that you guys may want to include in the resource plan. Again, the resource plan is what resources are we going to use to meet the future energy needs over the next 20 years. So, you know, solar is one that may be included, wind, geothermal, OTEC or ocean thermal energy conversion, biomass, wave energy, fuel cell, biofuels, conventional generation. And in addition to those generation technologies, here's a couple other programs that can impact the use of electricity, such as energy efficiency, demand response, or energy storage. Okay, so again, the purpose of these meetings tonight is to get public input on what resources you would like to see included in the planning process, and to collect comments on that and the IRP process in general. Okay, and with that, I'll turn it over back to Anel to facilitate the comments. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Matt. I don't know if you've noticed it, but there is a cameraman here from Akaku. So as you make comments, what I would encourage you to do is to use the microphone. Sorry that the microphone is at the front of the room, but we have a short cord, so we have no choice. But that way he can capture what it is you're saying if you use the microphone. And then of course we'll pull Sharon and Matt forward if there are questions that need to be answered. The other thing I need to say, bathrooms are behind us. Yes, and there is water in the cooler at the back of the room. Please go ahead and take advantage of it. Those of you that have not signed in when you came in, we'd encourage you to go to the back of the room also and sign in. So the purpose of this gathering is to hear from you, to hear what your thoughts are, your experiences here on Molokai. What is unique to Molokai that drives then some particular selection for some particular alternative resource? What works well, what doesn't work well, and any other comments that you would like to provide. And if your comments are inhibited because you have a question, then by all means, we want to try to provide you with as much information as you need. So who would like to speak first? Who is the brave soul? Aloha, come please. And if you would be willing to identify yourself, please.
Hi, I'm Cheryl Corbiel, and I'm representing myself, but I'm also a member of I Aloha Molokai.
Do you want me to turn this around so you can face people?
Yes.
Do you feel uncomfortable that way? Yes. I am sorry about that. Yes.
Yes, I do want to face the audience. So the points I'd like to make tonight for Miko and Hiko is no underwater seal cable, no community benefits for something as ludicrous as that. Why? Because I have no idea why you guys want to have a great big huge grid in a state that sits on top of a active volcanic plate. And so I found it interesting in one of the latest issues of Newsweek, one of the things that they talk about is if the New York area had not been a great big huge grid, there would not have been the power off as long as it was. And that they're saying that communities need to make smaller grids. They are to force their utilities to do so. So I'm telling you, no big grids, keep at least Molokai. I can't speak for the other islands, mm-hmm. but energy independent from the other islands, it's a whole lot safer. Our power stayed on in the last big earthquake. Mm-hmm. Oahu's went down, we at least had power. No big wind, again, stupid. We do not need it on this island. Oahu has to figure out how to control their own power usage. We need to focus on our power needs and what we're going to do to lower our power. And as far as I'm concerned, the IRP is not addressing that because all of the focus becomes Oahu because they're 80% of the state. So I'm not actually all that trusting nor have much faith so far in the IRP process because the focus is Oahu driven. What I find interesting is that your utility participates in activities such as putting 15% caps on solar photovoltaic residential use power. When Molokai, if all of the homes on Molokai went with solar voltaic, all we would need to figure out is how to have nighttime generation, which would put you guys out of business. So part of me has to say, I think this is a utility survival strategy that's getting built into the IRP. And we all know, and it was admitted to us, that 15% was a made-up figure. And even though you guys have said that you have lifted it, it's still in force, and you still have to go through some special studies and everything else for us to feed energy to Miko on Molokai, depending on what grid you're in. The other thing that really gets me is that if I don't have my dates wrong, that the IRP report is going to come out after when the request for proposals for projects. So I think that's kind of ass backwards the last time I went to school and took a planning course. So I can't quite figure out why that's happening, except that that means that you guys already know what the hell you're going to do and that the IRP process is not even a good process because you're not going to listen to what's in that report if, in fact, you're going to put out those RFPs before the report comes out. So the other thing that I thought was interesting is that you put in the list about cultural sensitivity and that kind of thing and put cost at the bottom. But when I look at all the minutes and everything else of the IRP process, cost is talked about and community and environment is on the bottom and is very low priority. So on this island, those things are really important to us. And so there needs to be more of a say besides the four people from Molokai that are on your committee. That does not represent the whole continuum of Molokai. And I doubt it does on any other island as well. So it's about time that you actually started listening to people. And unfortunately, I've had some bad experiences with Miko lately. So I am ye of little trust that they're going to listen to anything. Tried to turn my power off because my husband's name was on the bill. 19 years paid every bill, but that's not good enough. So in terms of planning, way back in the 1990s, early 2000, Miko, and you may not know this, Miko was brought into the 20th century kicking and screaming in that they didn't want to do demand-side management. And so I look at this situation and that I think Miko's in exactly the same place again. They're kicking and screaming and really, really don't want to change because it means that they've got to reinvent themselves. Because with demand-side management, the question, I sat on the advisory committee then, that it was interesting, the discussions about what they were going to do as a utility if everybody reduced their energy. And so I'm going, this is the same situation that you guys are doing protectionism and that, in fact, you need to reinvent yourselves, transform yourselves, just as you did with demand-side management. I also understand that in Lanai'i, that somebody from the company said something about that we're not really listening to the energy management that the company is putting out. Well, instead of spending hundreds of thousands of dollars on TV ads and everything else, we don't need to be convinced to lower our energy consumption. Our bills are high. Last time I checked, Lanai'i and us are the highest in the state and if not in the nation. So I don't think we are reluctant to save energy. I think we're doing a darn good job, but there are barriers and stuff like the 15% that we can't put PV on our house if you're in the wrong grid. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Oh, aloha. How are you?
Sorry, she's being high maintenance. Aloha, everyone. My name is Terry Waros, and I'm a small business owner here on Molokai. I have a store in town, and my monthly bill is about $500. Okay, so I'm going to piggyback on what Cheryl talked about. I was very discouraged because second to rent, that's my highest cost. So how can I affect that? And I was really interested in doing solar. And at the time, the 15% cap was enacted because the drugstore, the hospital, and the grocery store has solar on the roof. Robbie Elms was here a couple years ago and promised us that there was going to be a report on the Kanakakai grid that was going to address this 15% cap. I've never seen that report. I don't know if anybody else has ever received that report. Okay. So there is a little bit of distrust. Okay. A little bit of distrust because we've been told that they were going to look at it and that we were going to hear. There was some report being done and that it would be made available to our community. And again, to date, that we don't believe so. And even though the 15% is an arbitrary number, it was necessary, we were told, because our grids are not capable of handling renewable energy. There's no conversation that I have heard about that talks about how can we get our grids up to par to accept renewable energy. Okay, and right after we're capped, and then so as individuals, we're not allowed to put solar on our homes or in our businesses, Miko turns around and signs huge contracts with huge companies to put solar. So again, we need to make sure that we're doing this for the good of everybody. If our intention is to find the right answers to our energy needs for the next 20 years, that's a wonderful intention. But then we need to make sure that that's the direction that we're headed in. The minute that our intention becomes about profit, we've changed the direction, and we need to be very clear about that. At the same meeting, Robbie Alms at one point kind of threw up his arms and he said, I don't understand why we get such resistance to our big projects. And he mentioned geothermal on the Big Island. And of course, at the time, we're talking big wind of Molokai. And it seems so obvious to me because we don't need large impacts and footprints on our aina. Particularly on this island, we're very sensitive to that. And we need to make sure that we are at least considering small impact, decentralized generation. Of the 70% less dependency on fossil fuels, 30% of that is to come from conservation. Now, Molokai, we have the least amount of consumption per capita in our state. I think we do very well. And of course, part of it is we don't have big hotels and all of that. But to get people to conserve, 30% is a significant amount. And I remember the mom who told me the biggest impact she had on her kids is when they went off the grid, went to solar, and all of a sudden her kids had to come in the door, check their meter, and see how much power was available before they could decide whether to turn on their video games. So if you're actually gonna get 80% of our population in Hawaii being on Oahu to conserve, you need to consider decentralized generation, that they're responsible for producing their own power and they will be more conscious of conserving their own power. Either that or send them to camp on Molokai. We'll teach them how to do it. Okay. I think it's really necessary for all of us ratepayers. Again, a little bit of anger, a little bit of frustration and distrust here. As a ratepayer, to watch my legislators pass a bill last May that guarantees Hawaiian Electric, no matter whether the project is completed, whether we've ever generated a kilowatt of power, or whether we've ever transmitted a kilowatt of power, that the ratepayers are gonna be responsible for paying for the inter-island cable. It's wrong. It's not financially responsible, and it's not fair to all of us who pay our electric bills. Again, there is a question about the timing of the IRP process and the RFP. It doesn't seem to be very transparent and oftentimes can be regarded as a smokescreen if we're going through this process, but there's another process going on for the RFPs prior to the outcome of the IRP, which has the public input. Okay. And I just think what came up on the board that I had a question on, I'd love a definition of what MECO considers public policy on renewables. Okay. And just for the record, no windmills on our island. Not good for us, not good for our aina, not good for our communities, for our Mauna Loa folks, for any of us here, not good for our wildlife. No inter-island cable. It doesn't pencil out. I've had many people tell me that financially it doesn't make any sense. So we need more transparency with that. Thank you.
So either Matt or Sharon, can you help us understand what you mean when you talk about a public policy on renewables? If you could define what that means.
Well, I can definitely talk about a part of it is, you know, how does the public feel on renewables? You know, what do they want? And that some of that is what we're trying to gather here tonight.
And at some point there will be legislation created, a public policy will be created around whatever the consensus is around renewables? Is that what you mean?
Ideally, that's kind of outside of MECO's purview, but yeah, I mean, at least part of it is the utility can gather, the public input and incorporate that into our planning process.
Okay.
So
What is a renewable in your purview?
Then again, if you can clarify, what do we mean when we say renewable? That's that screen that where you showed all of these alternative energies. Can you repeat what a renewable means?
Sure. Well, generally, you know, something that's not fossil fuel, not imported oil, and preferably that uses a local resource to generate electricity. But again, I mean, even basic questions like that, we're trying to gather information tonight. Some places feel like waste energy is renewable. Is that what the people in Hawaii feel? And if not, maybe is that something we should include in the resource plan or something we shouldn't? I mean, so it's really all about gathering information and not coming in with, what the utility feels one way or the other.
But certainly some of the examples of renewable were up on the screen, which was solar energy and wave energy and wind energy.
Sure, I threw up some common things that are considered renewable, sort of to you know, get everyone thinking about it, get the juices flowing. But if there's other things that I didn't mention, feel free to bring them up and
come. Be careful climbing out of these. I hate these benches. I try to get my legs over and they won't go. So you be careful climbing over.
My name is Natalie Wilson. I was born on this island, and I'm a little concerned because when I was growing up, we had a dairy. We had an electric plant, which generated electricity for the island of Molokai. I know, because my father was the lineman that put all the lines out everywhere, okay? So this is extremely close to my heart. And when you talk about renewable, I'm going, aren't you talking about sustainable? Doesn't it have to be something that can continue? Not for 20 years, but for perpetuity. I mean, we have to look at the future for our children. I have seen wind power in California, in Arizona, lots of places all over the country. And you know what? They don't all work. You look at them and maybe 30% of them are working. Some of them aren't. You know, they have their limitations also. But where they are put are very large areas of land. Large areas of land. Molokai is not that big. You need at least a 200 by 200 foot pad, 100 foot deep, to sustain a 420 foot tower. Now, where are you going to put the dirt that you dig out of that pad and fill with cement? The dirt's got to go somewhere.
Wind doesn't work. What does work for Molokai?
I think that has got to be up to the people of Molokai. You know, which is okay. But there are some things that can be done. I've only been back a little while, and I'm starting to look into some of them. But there, on this island, there's a lot of Kiavi. Kiavi is a natural briquette, okay? It can be gathered and it can be used to help create energy, okay? There are
other non-native plants.
Right.
Other invasives.
And there are, but I think we need to look at what we have here before we take a look at what we got out there. You know, and that's all I'm saying. Let's take a look at what we have home and make use of our land and protect it.
Absolutely.
That's kind of the point. Then what does work? What works for Molokai is what we're here to hear from you. Yes, you could say this does not work. Then in the alternative, what does? Please come and join us.
Your name, please.
My name is Peggy Lucas Bond. I'm an electrical and ocean engineer and was one of the first women who lived underwater, so I have some experience with water. But tonight I'm here wearing two different hats. The first is that of a member of the West Molokai Association, the Homeowners Association of West Molokai Property Owners. In August, the WMA Board of Directors sent out to its members a petition for renewable energy and against the undersea cable and industrial wind turbines on Molokai. 274 owners signed this petition. A copy of the petition and the signatures is submitted with this comment. The signatories submit that we welcome the increased penetration of rooftop solar and PV hot water and urge the implementation of energy efficiency and energy conservation measures throughout the state, as well as on Molokai, and are opposed to the current ill-founded proposal for industrial wind turbines on Molokai and an undersea cable which goes through the Molokai Reef and the Hawaiian Islands Humpback Whale Natural Marine Sanctuary. We ask that our concerns be integrated into the current IRP process. My second hat is that of the author of a petition, No Cables Through the Humpback Whale Sanctuary. I started this petition as a comment to the Hawaiian Inter-Island Renewable Energy Program, Wind PEIS, and Hawaii Clean Energy PEIS. It was submitted to the Department of Energy on October 9, 2012, when it had 785 signatories from 44 U.S. states and territories and 53 different countries. There were 172 detailed comments from the signatories. Today, the petition has 906 signatures and 181 comments. I'm submitting another copy of that. The people worldwide are passionate about marine mammals and specifically whales. Their cares gave rise to the institutions such as our Hawaiian Humpback Whale Sanctuary. As one of the signatories said, no sanctuary is supposed to be a the sanctuary is supposed to be a sanctuary for the humpback whales. We have no idea how this untested technology to transmit power to Oahu will affect them. Other questions raised in the comments include, why should the ratepayers and the whales have to pay for this very expensive project? Whales are protected, why endanger them? The cable is too expensive. Aren't there better alternatives? Can't each Hawaiian island be energy sufficient? The message is clear, no cable in the whale sanctuary. Let the islands speak for themselves. Mahalo.
Aloha, my name is Greg Kahn. As a Molokai member of the IRP advisory group, I wanted to take some time to share some impressions of my experience so far with people in the community here. Despite the language in the mission of the IRP, which encourages rigorous debate and minority viewpoints, there's never any discussion of energy philosophy in a future action plan. How can an IRP advisory group have any teeth when the utility has already decided that it will pursue inter-island connectivity via an undersea cable? How can an IRP advisory group give advice when the utility has already accepted Big Wind as a viable plan without any debate? Questions which are fundamental to Molokai's energy future are not on the utility's IRP agenda. For instance, what are the consequences of adopting industrial-scale wind turbines on Molokai? Will there be huge amounts of erosion and dust? Will reefs have to be dynamited? Will there be cutting off of access to hunting grounds and cultural sites? Will hundreds of miles of access roads be built to go to the turbines? Will they decimate native birds and plants? These questions are not being debated during the IRP process. For instance, should a rural island have to bear the costs for energy that it exports to an urban island? And not just the monetary costs of higher monthly bills, but the cost of industrializing a rural island, the cost of adverse environmental impacts on a rural island, the cost of degrading a native culture on a rural island, the cost of altering the social fabric on that island, the cost of depressing an already fragile economy, and the cost of health concerns. These questions are not being addressed by the IRP. And what are the reasons for inter-island connectivity via an undersea cable? Wouldn't linking all of the islands make us vulnerable to service interruptions? Since the ratepayer is footing the bill for the multi-billion dollar cable, should the utility have access to this asset that they didn't even pay for? These questions are not being debated at the IRP. Another example, As the utility's profit motive is central to its decision-making process, can we really expect them to act in the best interests of the community, in the best interests of the ratepayer? We do not discuss these questions at all at the IRP. For instance, why wouldn't island energy independence, in other words, Molokai generating energy for Molokai, be the preferred future for us? This question is not being considered as an action plan. What we are left with is an IRP process where the utility is mandated to listen to the advisory group, but not bound to follow its advice. What we are left with is an IRP process which allows the utility to create an illusion that it's incorporating the advice of communities such as Molokai in energy decisions that they are making. What we are left with is an IRP process which looks a lot like window dressing. But what we are also left with is a Molokai process. It's a process where members of the community come to meetings, debate the issues, speak out for what they think is the best for the island. I'm confident that this process will render an energy action plan, and it's going to be in our best interests. And that plan will not include an undersea cable, that plan will not include big wind, and that plan will not include corporate bribes disguised as community benefits.
Aloha. Thank you for coming. Am I there? Okay. Now you're asking what works for our island. Now are these questions also being directed to Oahu?
Yes.
What can they do on their island that will work for their island, not what we can do that'll work for their island?
Yes.
Are these being And what are those answers?
Well, the answers are as multiple as yours are, as you can see. And they're being noted, and as I said, comments will be posted on that IRP website, so you can look it up later.
Okay. Now, with the RFP already in progress, prior to the results of the PEIS, I'd like some of the questions answered that I submitted to the EIS before the RFP, such as the smart grid. How much radiation will people be exposed to because of the smart grid? You have to have transmitters into their homes on each of their appliances.
Good question. Do you want them to attempt to answer now, or do you want to just make your statement?
I would like answers because the PEIS isn't going to be until later, but the PUC has already put in their request for proposals for the cable. Are these things being considered?
So is there radiation that emanates from these?
People have a choice for hazardous items. If you choose to use a cell phone, you're choosing to put that radiation near your ear, next to your head. You have that option. If the smart grid takes place and you have transmitters for each of your appliances, a transmitter box outside of your house, and then a centralized hub for this information, you don't have a choice. It's being imposed on you. Is the public going to be notified to the health hazards of these things? Prior to it, are they going to have the option to opt out?
Well, I'm not familiar with the PEIS, but Maui Electric has several smart grid things going on Maui, and those are all voluntary. So nobody, we don't enforce a smart meter on anyone that doesn't want it. They have to let us know that they do want it before we install that in their house. So I can only speak to, you know.
And do you know about the radiation?
I don't know a lot about it. I heard it's similar to, you know, other things that we use every day. Like really? Cell phones, like you mentioned.
But again, phones are just as dangerous.
Right. So we're not enforcing that on anyone. If they want a smart meter and they want to experience it, they can volunteer for the program.
So when Hawaii builds this new smart grid that we're all supposed to pay for with our rate paying and our taxes, what? Who's going to pay for the doctor bills when we have radiation exposure?
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly.
See, you guys are putting a smart grid into place, whether it's voluntary or involuntary, you still have the centralized hub that's going to be exposing people and animals.
So it would seem that Matt doesn't know the answer to
no,
the question.
No, it would seem, and that's my point right there, is that if something is put in place, and just like Matt, poor thing, I'm sorry, but you don't know, that's a big problem. You're putting risk. People don't know what they're being exposed to.
I just wanted to clarify, at least for Maui Electric and our service territory, which is Maui, Lanai, and Molokai, mm-hmm. we have not made a commitment to, on a broad scale, install the smart grid technology. We have received some funding through the U.S. Department of Energy, so the federal agency, to do that demonstration project. I believe we have under 200 meters. So these were volunteers that volunteered to be part of this demonstration project, and we're just testing out the technology.
And were they made aware of the radiation?
So yes, I mean, again, I don't have the details, but it's not supposed to have much electromagnetic field impact, more like cell phones and or baby monitors. So
Sharon, if you're in the process, if this is a demonstration uh-huh. project, then I would think MECO is in the process of analyzing and will come to.
So we're trying to learn more about it to see if it's something that we should look into further. We're going to evaluate after we get information from, maybe for a year from the meters. So we have not, made a commitment to, yes, we're going to do it broad scale. I just wanted to clarify that point. We will take your concern, into consideration as we evaluate the, results of this demonstration project, because we have heard that also from others in our Maui community. Are we monitoring the people? No. I don't know if we're monitoring the site, and I don't think we're monitoring the people. But we'll make note.
Yes.
And
see, that's the issue here, is that things get put into place, and then it's observed and it's monitored to whatever extent they are capable of doing.
It's a demonstration project. The purpose is for the purpose of evaluation, and decisions have not been made. This is not a permanent. This is analyzing, evaluating.
So we accept your concern, and we, what you're bringing up today, and we're here to listen, accept, and try to incorporate it into our planning processes, and even for this smart grid demonstration project.
Okay. Can I just ask a brief question? Before you raise another issue, can I allow her to finish? Thank you.
Okay. Also, the wind turbines. You guys are using wind turbines on Maui. Is that for Maui Electric? Or is that going to be for power on Oahu?
I'm sure currently all the wind farms being built on Maui are for Maui.
They're for Maui?
Yes.
Okay. Are you aware of vibroacoustics disease? vibroacoustics disease. Okay. Vibroacoustics disease is caused by infrasound and low frequency noise. Research into VAD has been going on since 1980, conducted by a team of scientists led by a pathologist, Dr. Castillo Branco in Portugal. Okay, initially, they were monitoring this low frequency noise in occupation environments. But more recently, this team obtained irrefutable acoustic measurement results from within homes near wind turbines that show proof that wind turbines in the proximity of residential areas can lead to the development of vibroacoustic disease. Vibroacoustic disease is not wind turbine syndrome. This is an actual disease and it can be tested for in a hospital environment. This is your body's way of trying to adapt to the constant vibration of low frequency noise. It thickens the cardiovascular walls. It causes lung fibrosis. It causes neuromuscular disorders, seizures, early onset of Alzheimer's disease. These are issues that through communications via the internet, a researcher for one of the top researchers for vibroacoustic disease communicated to me that if you know someone living in a low frequency noise contaminated home, she could not stress it enough. She said, move. Whatever you do, do not sleep in that home. If you cannot move, do not be there for most of the day and do not sleep there. Because the onset of it is much stronger and faster than in an occupational environment. So these things need to be taken into consideration, whether it be the windmills here, which I am totally against, or the windmills on Maui. Also, she noted, and she also stressed, was that the low frequency noise should be measured prior to development and after, using the proper weighting. An A-weighted measurement is insufficient for low frequency noise. In regards to our reefs, over 50% of cancer research right now is found from the ocean and our reefs. If you had cancer, or you, what would you rather have? A cure for cancer or a high voltage direct current cable? What if the one sure cure was irreversibly eradicated because of that cable? How well would you sleep? Turbines, going back to turbines, you have them in Maui. Do you know where those magnets come from? China, because that's where those rare minerals are. There is a lake in China that is toxic sludge. No farm can raise cattle or grow food around this toxic waste. People are dying of cancer. Their teeth are falling out, and babies are being born with soft bone disease. Two of these magnets, the size of cars, go into each wind turbine. How can we, as human beings, justify the death of these people and the death of their land? It doesn't make sense for something that doesn't work. What we do need to see is more solar. Keeping a business going is not as important as living. Good evening, aloha.
Aloha.
I'm going to make it real, real short. I am an advocate for clean energy. And I've always been pleased with our Hawaii Electric. Since Oahu is going to, well, it's facing our energy crisis, and I always feel that Lanai, Kauai, Oahu is all ours. And then when there is trouble, the need, we really should kukua. But in this case, for Molokai, what can we give if we don't have, right? I just hope that our electric company can work with solar. That's all. But as far as me personally wanting the wind farm, no, it's not going to do us any good. We're just one dot in a map, okay? And as far as the cable, that is also no for Molokai, because our fishermen, you know, if you put that, you have to put a big sign that says, danger, no swimming, no fishing. And our people, they fish before the big water, okay? And it will just change, you know, we are not so rich over here. As a matter of fact, we're poor. Well, that's all I want to say. No wind farm for Molokai.
My name's Les Wiley. I'm West End resident. I'm also a member of Ailoa Molokai. And I'm going to try and follow up on Greg's excellent presentation. I think it wins the award for this evening. One of my biggest problems I'm having with this whole process is a lack of information. We have a 26-page handout here. We've been talking about windmills for over a year. I never see any numbers. It's all just talks, pretty slides. This document here was very expensive, but it doesn't talk about things like the future. It doesn't give us any numbers in which to make decisions. How can we make decisions if we don't have the data to make those decisions? I feel a little like I've walked into an auto dealership. I walk up to the salesman, and I say, salesman, I want a fast car. And he says, how much money do you have? And I say, $3 billion. He says, I'll tell you what, I'll get you a car that can go 110 miles an hour, break the speed limit in every state in the nation, and I'll have it in your house tomorrow. Just go home, I'll deliver the car, and a month from now you get your first bill and a statement how much this car is going to cost you. That's why I feel like the process here. We don't have any numbers. How do we know what windmills cost, what any of these things cost? We never talk about the future, we never talk about the cost. Give you a few examples of things that concern me. Talking about the futures to first with. There's been reports by a guy named Pad Chin Chow. He's the head of the Hawaiian State Climate Office. He's been talking about the number of trade wind days we have here in the islands. Between 1973 and 2009, a period of 36 years, the number of trade wind days has dropped by 80. There's 80 fewer days now than there were in 1973. And this dropping a number of trade wind days is going to continue into the future. The northwest, northeast trade wind days are dropping and the trade winds are switching to the east. Two problems here. One is we're going to build windmills that need wind. Are we taking into account the fewer days of wind we're going to have in the future? We're dropping about 2.2 days a year. And you add up the total number of days when there's less wind, it adds up to a significant amount of month. Over the life of the project, 20 years, there can be 44 fewer days every year when we have trade wind days. And that's not insignificant. That comes out of our pocket. Have we accounted for that? Does anybody talk about it? Do I see it on a piece of paper? Somebody may have discussed it, but I don't know if it's ever been mentioned. And we have no way of knowing whether it's been taken into account. There are consequences of this switch in the trade winds. One of them is the wind trade winds come out of the east instead of the northeast, and that's causing drought conditions in the islands. Those of you who lived here know about how the drought has occurred. All you have to do is go to the Big Island right now. There's Rainbow Falls down there, which is one of the biggest draws in the islands for tourists. That falls aren't falling. There's no water. And Molokai has been a drought for 8 years and more, and those of you who have lived here for longer know the drought we have. So one of the problems is going to be water to build these windmills. The problem of digging a hole in the ground and filling it full of concrete was mentioned. If you're going to build make concrete, you actually have pure water. Nobody's talked about the water we need. One thing they talk about, a desalinization plant. Well, there's an article in the Washington Post today talking about the problems with water availability in the western United States. They said San Diego currently pays $800 an acre foot for water, and as the Colorado River dries up, there's talk about doing desalinization. If they desalinize or recycle wastewater, it's going to cost $1,800 an acre foot. If they bring it up from just salt water, it's going to be $2,150 per acre foot. Is this being taken into account? Both the cost of running this desalinization plant, building it, the damage it's going to cause to the island. These things are not being addressed. It's just pretty pictures and that sort of thing. My big concern, that's above all others, is that we can't build infrastructure fast enough to keep up with demand. We have to change the whole way we look about it. Nobody talks about, we talk about conservation, which is all well and good, but we have to just take a whole new route. Like these people here have lived off the grid. Hawaii is going to have, it can't keep on doing business as usual. Again, as an engineer, they do back of the envelope computations. I've got an envelope here and the back here has got some computations I tried to run to prove my point. I'm using my own numbers because HECO doesn't be forthcoming with their numbers, so I get to make up my own numbers, right? I have two reports here. One is the says the size of Hawaii's energy sector, and the other is the potential of renewable energy to reduce dependence on the state of Hawaii on oil. In that report, they say that currently, this was 2010, HECO can put in their own numbers, there is 2,414 megawatts of statewide electrical production. This other report says the electrical industry in Hawaii is growing at a rate of 9%. There's a simple rule that even a kindergartner can do. If you want to know how fast something is growing, such as your bank account, getting it at 5% per year, cost of muffins next year at Albertsons, increasing at 2% a year, how much it's going to cost to put your kid through school in the future, you can do a simple calculation in your head. You take the rate of growth, divide it into the number 70, and that tells you how long it takes to be twice as big. Example, if you take 9% and divide it into 70, you get 8. That means in 8 years, the demand for energy will be twice as big as it is today. So, if you have 2,414 megawatts needed today, it'll be 4,828 megawatts needed tomorrow. If you wait 16 years, the demand will be 9,656 megawatts. If you wait 24 years, 19,312 megawatts. We can't keep up with that growth. Right now, according to this report, if you used all the renewable energy sources in Hawaii, you build them on top of people's houses anywhere you want it, you can create 2,133 megawatts of power. That's if tomorrow, which is 80 8% of the energy demands of the state. But at the end of 8 years, the energy demands can be twice as much. You've already used up all your renewable energy. You can't build no more. There's no more available. And so you start out with 88%, then you go 8 years, you got 44%, 16 years, 22% developed by renewable energy, 24 years, you got 11%, and after 32 years, which is the age of some of the people in this room, all our renewable energy only creates 2% of the total demand of the energy involved. The point I'm trying to make is that our real problem is not keeping up with demand, it's changing demand itself. We have to do something different. Just like Terry said here a few minutes ago, if you walk into your house and there's a meter on the wall that says you have this much power today, you can use it, you're going to be more in tune with your energy needs. And the state should be spending that $3 billion on making people buy smaller cars, solar PV on the rooftops, solar hot water here. If they did put this $3 million into that kind of processing, completely changing the way we live, we're going to be forced into this whether we like it or not. I don't care if you want it or not, whether it's in your future or not. The numbers say it's going to happen to you. It's inevitable. It's and all of us, including HECO. HECO's in this same boat. I feel a little like a lifeboat. I'm sitting at the end of the lifeboat. The HECO guy's down the other end. And all of a sudden, I spring a leak. And he says, I say, hey, come help me with my leak. And he says, that's not my problem. My end doesn't have a leak. But when that boat goes down, we're both going in the water. And this is a problem that faces all of us, the energy companies and the citizens. And the numbers don't lie. We design bridges. We design airplanes. We design cars using numbers. And anybody can sit down with a piece of paper and some numbers and come up with these answers. And we don't got any numbers. Nobody's given us any numbers. Where are the numbers? And basically, that's what I would say is we have to go a different way. Math doesn't lie. And those are my comments.
My name is Mike Bond. I'm on Molokai. Les has just been asking about numbers. Maybe I can provide a few. And I just mentioned that I spent 30 years in the energy business, CEO of an energy company. I spent a lot of time dealing with electricity issues. I chaired the international committee that integrated the Soviet Union's electricity grid with the West and all that kind of stuff. So I've spent a lot of time trying to understand what this so-called Big Wind project and the silly cable is all about. And in my 30 years in the energy business, I have never seen, and I wrote down four things about this that are special. This project makes the least economic sense of any project I've seen in the last 30 years. It's the most environmentally destructive project I've seen in the last 30 years. You can't take 17 square miles of the most beautiful island in the Pacific and trash it and say that's not environmentally destructive. This is the most, excuse me, I've lost my voice. This is the most unilaterally and completely unanimously opposed of any project, energy project I've ever seen. Repeatedly, over 90% of the citizens against it. Even when HECO is throwing out the promise of all kinds of community benefits. And this is also the most insanely one-sided marketed by HECO. Or any utility of any project I've ever seen, and despite the fact it makes no economic sense, it's environmentally catastrophic, and it's almost entirely opposed. So those are four issues about this project which blow my mind, frankly. There's no economic engineering or environmental sense to this project. Its sole purpose, as far as I can see, is to give HECO a big project to put in its books so it can borrow against it. As we all know, HECO is one step away from junk bonds, and this is one of the ways they're trying to prevent it. And I have to salute Greg Kahn for his honesty in pointing out that the whole IRP process is nothing but window dressing. If you look at what the state of Hawaii is saying, what Mark Glick is saying, he's saying this project's going to go through. They don't care. They don't, and HECO wants the project. This, it has nothing, whether we're here, whether we all say we're against it, makes no difference to HECO. I've got so many things to say about this that it's, that I feel like, let's see, I can't even, I have printed some of them up. If you take 400 megawatts of big wind and you look at a 20% capacity factor, that takes it down to 40 megawatts. You're going to lose another 3 to 4% in the transmission, so that takes it down to 38 megawatts. Then you have to consider that half the time the darn project is going to be running, they're not going to want the power. They're not going to want the power at 2 a.m., so they're going to curtail it. So that 38 megawatts, you're down to about 20. And then you have to consider, which of course the utility doesn't want to do, the fact that when you run wind, you have to run fossil fuel right alongside it. It's called spinning reserve, because, and you guys know all that, the generation, the wind power goes up and down and up and down and up and down, and you have to constantly keep the same amount of juice flowing into your grid. So you run your fossil fuel plant. So you still, so you got to deduct from that 20 megawatts, you've got to deduct the supplemental cost of all that fossil fuel use. So you're down to about 10 megawatts when you're done. 10 megawatts is 2%, less than that of Honolulu's power needs. I don't know, but it's ludicrous. When you consider the cost of this, I wrote 15 things down. I'll try to go through them fast. You have to consider the real capacity factor, not the pro forma one, not the one the engineers lie to you about. You have to consider the cost of the materials, the construction, and the operation of the cost of all of that to run this ridiculous project. You have to consider, as Janelle was talking about earlier, the impacts of the materials manufacturing, the transport. That's another cost. You have to consider the transmission loss. You have to consider the enormous cost of upgrading the systems on Oahu to take this project. You have to look at the frequent curtailment. Wind on Molokai blows when you don't need it. That's a major problem with wind projects. You have to consider, as I said, all of the costs of the spinning reserve. Then you have to think about decommissioning. Decommissioning in 20 years, this idiotic thing is going to have to be taken apart, or we're going to have more turbines sitting around that are not moving. Okay, you decommission it. You're going to take all of those, what is it, 1,000? More than that. I think, Larry, you know, how many tons of concrete is there in one of these things? One base, something like 1,000 tons? Something like that. Anyway, so you, what are you going to do with all that concrete? You're going to put it in the reef? You're going to leave it there forever? You know, and so what the wind power people say, oh, we're going to use this, we're going to recycle all this. The fact is none of that stuff is recyclable. Nobody wants it. So that's another lie. And we have all the environmental impacts, many of which can't be mitigated. There's the seals, there's the whales, all of our birds, endangered birds. You have social costs, many of which can't be mitigated. You cannot take the most beautiful island in the Pacific and trash it and bring in 600 outside workers and then expect this magnificent social fabric that we have here to sustain itself. You can't do that. You can't come in and take this beautiful place and trash it. So those, that cannot be mitigated. You're going to have a property value loss. Even Molokai Ranch admits that property values will go down up to 75% where these turbines are going to be located. And there's plenty of studies out there within 2 to 5 miles, 50% property value loss. What they're finding in many states now is then you have to go and say, okay, you get a 50% property value loss, you have to lower the taxes. So what's the loss in the tax base in Maui County? Substantial, very substantial. The best I can figure, there's about a $400 million property value loss just on the west end if you put the turbines where Pattern Energy wants to put them. What about tourism? There's lots of windmills in the UK. They're now finding, as best they can determine, wind turbines within 7 miles of site results in a 43% drop in tourism. But that doesn't matter because Hawaii doesn't depend on tourism. We don't need tourism, you know, so. I mean, it goes on. And Janelle brought up another good point. The fact is that infrasound and low-frequency sound are significant problems. They're serious problems. There's plenty of good medical peer-reviewed stuff out there that indicates that within 2 and up, in some cases, up to 7.5 kilometers away, people are suffering from the impacts of low-frequency sound. This is medical. This is not something made up by hippies who oppose wind turbines. So there's that. And already, and there's no way, again, I forget, several people have raised it, the problem of Already we have the highest electricity rates in the nation. And we're getting stuck with this cable, the cost of the cable. In addition, we're going to get stuck with all kinds of costs related to the construction of the turbines. It just goes on and on. It's ridiculous. It's going to raise, as best I can tell, having factored these kinds of things in my head for 30 years, it's going to cause a 30% increase in our rates. And sure, some of it's going to be paid by taxpayer subsidies, but who pays the taxes? We're already $1.7 trillion more deficit this year than last year. So it goes on and on and on. I just want to get to one other thing, and that's solar. Germany just announced that up to one-third of its peak generation now is solar. So every year, Germany creates more solar generation than is necessary to fuel the entire nation of Austria. By the end of the year, they're going to increase between June and September, they were going to increase their solar penetration another 30%. Right now, Germany's solar, rooftop solar and commercial solar, is the equivalent of 16 high output nuclear power plants. They are trying to approach 50% of peak load from rooftop and commercial solar. For HECO and MECO to drag us through the mud and say, no, 15% is the max. Oh, you're going to have to do another $20,000 study before you can go over 15%. That 15% number is absolutely and totally arbitrary. It was made up by a bunch of guys in California sitting around a table. It has absolutely no engineering value or any engineering sense. So I would ask, since you're right here, Sharon, you're the president of MECO, I would ask you to open up at least to 50%. There is no engineering, there is absolutely no engineering argument against 50% solar penetration of maximum load. So I only have about a million other things I was going to say. Excuse me, I would just add one more thing. Great Britain announced in October it is canceling all future on-land wind projects for a number of reasons. Number one, please bear with me. Number one, they find that wind generation does not lower CO2. Oh, I'm sorry. It doesn't lower CO2 production, and it doesn't reduce fossil fuel use because of spinning reserve. I'm sorry.
Take your time.
I'm almost done. Let me have one more swallow. What basically they said is they've come, and this is the British Environment Minister said, that industrial wind may have worse impacts than climate change. And they are getting out of it, and they also said that it is causing widespread social insurrection. And I just want to leave you with a thought. I mean, my ohana, the Malahini side's only been here 180 years. The other side has been here ever since the first Hawaiians. And we're all over this place in every single, and particularly the Big Island, and every single member of the hundreds of my ohana says to me, stop big wind. So if you think that the British are having a social insurrection problem with wind power, you try to bring big wind to Molokai.
And I don't think I'm going to add anything to what's already been said here, but I will just go through it. I want to thank you people for coming to Molokai, and I want to thank you for the opportunity to speak. I do understand this meeting is being chaired by the electric company, but I also understand that a private corporation has no obligation to listen to anything I say and I don't expect them to. I am therefore addressing my remarks to the elected representatives on the IRP, to the appointed members of the PUC, and to the governor who appoints them. They are obliged to listen. A pushy journalist once cornered Gandhi and demanded to know just what he thought of Western civilization. His reply was, he thought it would be a good idea. I feel the same way about resource planning in Hawaii. A state made up of small, fragile islands desperately needs a thoughtful, creative planning process and the political will to enforce it. I think this IRP group could be part of that effort. It certainly includes some of our state's most knowledgeable and creative people in the energy field. It's a great idea to bring government and business and experts together to discuss our energy future. But is this really planning? Is it planning when the first paragraph of the enabling docket says the utility is free to ignore the IRP recommendations? Is it planning when the RFP for the undersea cables is due long before you release your recommendations? Is it planning when the impacts of the cable and related projects on local communities, on the environment, and on ratepayer wallets are not integrated at all, but only included as afterthoughts? Is it planning when the monopoly utility's equipment, financial condition, and capacity for reform are excluded from the discussion? Don't get me wrong, I applaud your intentions, but please, let's do this right. To me, that means halt the RFP, take all the issues and impacts into account, protect the natural resources and the beauty of Hawaii, shine your searchlight on the utility itself, and require that utility to comply with your recommendations. Unless you do these things, you may find yourselves in the absurd position of killing tourism to boost the economy, or destroying hunting, fishing, and ranching on Molokai in the name of sustainability. To paraphrase Gandhi, I think integrated resource planning would be a good idea. Why don't we give it a try? Mahalo.
Crandall. I reside on the west end of Molokai, and I've never been to a public meeting where I agreed with every person who came before me. But I think it's indicative of the way we've come together as a community with a consensus on the detriment to the island of an industrial wind energy plant, which is not to say that we aren't very interested in renewables. Many of us use them, we want them, and given the opportunity, we would like to participate meaningfully in the process. The problem is this process is so flawed, it's so futile, and we've done something rather terrible to deceive us here. And I'm going to put somebody on the spot for it, and excuse me, but I think we have a consumer advocate representative in our presence tonight. Is that true, John?
Yes.
Right. And this is the situation we are facing in the PUC. We have, you know, the RFP process and the IRP process going on two different tracks. One is should be slowed down, and there is currently pending in the PUC RFP proceeding a motion to stay that proceeding until the IRP process is completed. That motion was joined in by several other entities. It sits there, it languishes there. The PUC refuses to act on it. And my question to the consumer advocate who represents all of us, why haven't you filed that motion for us? Why don't you support the motion that's currently pending? Don't we have a representative who takes our concerns directly to the PUC? Why do we have to appear meeting after meeting saying the same thing? We don't want this. It's not right. The scale's wrong. The devastation to the environment is horrendous. If we're going to look at renewables, we need to look at them on a site-specific basis. And you've already mentioned that some of the things you're looking at now in the IRP process are the impacts on cultural resources, environmental resources, the financial consequences. And I'm going to throw, we always say we don't want to look at financial consequences, although there have been good attempts tonight. And I want to say that there's a whole range of financial costs, costs that are financially related for all of the meetings, all of the energy, all of the spend every day to come here, to travel. Our agencies go back and forth and back and forth for years on end, spending taxpayer money. What are those costs doing out there? Are they included in the costs of the billions that go into the cable, of the millions that go into the whatever wind energy plant we may or may not have? We don't really look at this in a practical, pragmatic, holistic fashion. Thank you. That's all I have to say.
John, it's not my intention to put you on the spot, but a question was asked, and I'm wondering if you feel comfortable to answer it.
So I guess that there is a motion to try to stay the RFP process while this IRP process is going through, but that
the PUC has not taken action on it. And why hasn't then the consumer advocate come forward to try to urge that state? Okay, well, aloha. Good evening, everyone. Again, John Itamura, representing the Consumer Advocate's Office tonight. Jeffrey Ono has also been to many of the IRP meetings throughout the islands. Our main intent, I want to start by saying our main intentions to be present at these meetings, I was also present at the PEIS meeting that was here a few months ago, is to gather as much information as we can. And as many of you are keenly aware, so many of the issues that come before the PUC, that come before us now, are all interrelated, very separate and distinct, yet now becoming very interrelated. And therefore, as a Consumer Advocate's Office, we have to be very wary of the consumer interest as a whole, the consumer interest, some people mentioned, looking forward. And that's not an easy task to do when you have so many yet distinct dockets, yet very interrelated issues. So with respect to the question, we've looked at the motion. We understand we're also intimately involved in the process. The idea of stopping the RFP has many ramifications. The RFP is a process that brings in a lot of information we may not readily would have access to otherwise. And that, I leave you with that thought. There's a lot of you could have your own conclusions about that, but again, our process going forward is really to get as much information as possible, and one way to do that is to allow some of these processes to move forward so that we can see, because the fact that we're not doing one thing or another doesn't really dictate what our position is in any particular docket.
I believe his answer is, his answer, as I heard it, was that is yes, they want the RFP process to go through because it provides them with more information. Not we're going to support the motion to stop, but what I heard was we support the motion, the RFP going forward. Yes? Oh, well, it's possible, but the official state, I'm just responding, sir, to a question that's asked. And what I heard him say is consumer advocates see a need for the RFP process, and you don't intend to stay the RFP process.
Respond to the motion, right? Apparently not.
No.
No, it's not a matter of ignoring, but if you want to talk process, when a motion goes before the PUC, the consumer advocate can give its position, can oppose, it can support, or can take no position. Not on the RFP motion, no. And but there's a very short time. There's about a 5-day window to respond to a motion, and for an issue as big as this, that's not enough time for us to make that type of a decision.
It sounds as if you want to gather just as much information as possible, and yet the way the schedule is going, this process will be not part of the RFP. Is that correct, or am I misunderstanding the timing? In other words, what we say tonight and what's been said on other islands is going to come after the RFP, so they won't take that information into consideration.
So what is, if I understand the process, Miko, jump in if I'm wrong. The process is that you will be coming up with an action plan in
March?
Mid-2013. In the meantime, the RFP on various types of resources is moving forward. Yes, that's correct.
Define RFP for me, please.
Yeah, so
I have a contract background, and that's I misunderstand what is being said.
Sure. So I RFP stands for Request for Proposals, and as I understand it, there is a draft RFP out for something like 200 megawatts of energy to be provided to Oahu. It's not specific that it needs to be on Molokai or Lanai. It can be on Oahu. And it's no cable is inherent in the RFP. There could be not. If they can get 200 megawatts on Oahu, no cables needed, no wind farm on Molokai. So I mean, that's my understanding. So nothing is, the RFP isn't for 200 megawatts of wind on Molokai. It's just 200 megawatts of renewable energy to Oahu. And whatever comes in through that process will be evaluated.
That's the wording of the RFP.
As I understand it. So with regards to the timing of all these things, you know, many of the utility projects takes, you know, many years to complete. In fact, that RFP has been out for months and months and months, and it's still in draft form. It hasn't even been issued yet. Nobody can respond to it. And so with the action plan coming out mid next year, I don't believe that anything would even be awarded from that RFP prior to that time.
Who will it be issued to?
It's issued, as I understand it, again, so a slight clarification, I kind of work for MECO, and it's primarily HECO that's doing a lot of the RFP work. But as I understand it, it would just be to the public, anyone that wants to propose a project that could meet the requirements of the RFP, again, something like 200 megawatts to Oahu, however that may be. If solar farm on Oahu, fine, it can be that. And then there would be some period for people to sort of come up with a project that could meet the requirements of the RFP and submit their proposal, like we can do it for so many dollars. And then there would be some time over which HECO would evaluate all those proposals. And I think that's kind of some of the information that maybe the consumer advocate would like to see. You know, how much would a solar farm on Oahu cost? How much would it cost if it was on Maui? You know.
Okay. So with the RFP that is to be issued, will there be reports of the community meetings and the community positions on the various types of issues, whatever they may be?
I don't think that's so much part of the RFP process. It's definitely part of the IRP process. And I know some questions have come up. Why do those things happen in parallel? Again, because you know, the projects for these type of scale take many, many, many years. And you know, we all hear everyone's concern over the costs of electricity, and we don't want to stop our planning, you know, for those things that take multiple years for something, you know, while we do this IRP process and gather more information hopefully that can inform our future decisions.
Okay, but you hear, I wonder if you could yield for a moment. There are a few other people who want to ask questions. Sir, you wanted to ask a question?
I just want to ask how much work has been done, like laying the cable and so on, before the RFP is completed?
Inter-island cable?
Yeah.
As far as I know, none.
None.
Yeah. I mean, there may not even be a cable involved in whatever is awarded from the RFP. That's my understanding.
Yes. That man has his hand up. Do you have a question?
A question. So actually, what we're talking about is very hypothetical. Huh? You can be here all night talking about hypothetical information you're gathering. Gathering information for who?
For
what? Where's the teeth? I mean, you're telling me it's way down the road, you know what I mean? Could you give me a little guarantee that something's positive? Because you haven't said anything about all the negatives that we all know about. So I can't sit here all night and listen to, you know, down the road, gathering information for me. You haven't told me anything.
Okay, let him answer the question. What are you gathering information for? Is it for your planning process?
Yeah, well, for the IRP, the purpose of this meeting here tonight is to inform our planning, inform the utility planning for future meeting future energy needs. That's the purpose.
I think the other answer to your question is that ultimately, anything the utility does, any utility, whether it's water, gas, electricity, goes before the PUC. So that is who you're gathering information for. The PUC makes the ultimate decision. Now, whether their public policy is mandated by statute, mandated by a governor's, mandate in various forms, That's a totally different issue. But the information goes before the PUC. What comes from the RFP has to then take a different form, go through the process to get approval, PUC approval. At that time, whatever information, I just speak for our office, the consumer advocate gets, will be in that proceeding, will be representing a lot of the comments that are here. You'll see our comments probably come through in the way of what we call IRs, information requests. You'll see it. If you go to the website, the DMS called Document Management System run by the PUC, you'll notice, I guarantee you, you'll see your comments coming out in our IRs, our information requests.
So as decisions are being made by the regulator of the utility, which is the Public Utility Commission, part of what they're taking into consideration are some of these requests for proposals and the data that comes back from them. And the utility must make those reports to the regulator of the utility, and that is the Public Utility Commission. There were just too many acronyms for me at that point. It's like, yikes.
Yes, ma'am. Which brought up, and what I wanted to ask before, and I'm sorry, none of us want to put anyone on the spot, but yes. Matt, you mentioned you weren't really familiar with the other process that's going on, which is the PEIS. And that is equally important, and many of us have participated in that. So again, it looks to us that the RFP process coming ahead of the final environmental impact, a problematic environmental impact study, is like putting the cart before the horse. Okay, so and you said you weren't even familiar, and that's why I wanted to ask Sharon when she was up there. I hope you're familiar with what's going on with the PEIS process. Another acronym.
Ma'am? That would be two carts before one horse.
I mean, okay. There is good reason for a community to feel frustrated, and there are a number of agencies engaged in this very complex project. And perhaps we need to pull everybody into the room when we do these kinds of community meetings so that we get a better perspective, more informed perspective. But thank you for raising that. Ma'am, you were raising your hand and I had stopped you from speaking.
I spoke before when I was sitting here. But it's very frustrating to know that nothing that we have said in the past for all these years has made one bit of difference.
Can that be possible? That can't be possible.
Yes.
Nothing that we have said has made a bit of difference.
You know, and this is another instance of this. BOEM, the Bureau of Ocean Management, has an advisory task force that none of us knew about in last March, I don't believe. Were all of the agencies you just referred, wouldn't it be good to bring all of them in one room? Well, they did bring a lot of people into one room, but they forgot to invite us.
Yeah.
We didn't know about it till last week. If you want to go to YouTube and listen to 4 hours plus, I don't think you know how you even went to that. But it's another example of another meeting which is out there somewhere. Maybe it's the third card. I don't know. But it's not a process that goes into common sense. What do we want and what does this appear?
Perhaps we need to write our own.
Perhaps
you do. Perhaps you do. This woman has her hand up. Okay, because we've been going sort of fast and furious, everybody talking at once, we have neglected to go to the microphone, which means Akaku may not catch what it is you're saying. And that's a disservice. So if you're comfortable about coming to the microphone, then we know you'll be heard. But if you just want to stand there, I'm fine with that. Up to you.
I'm a loudspeaker.
Okay.
So when we're talking about carts before the horse, let's actually go back so that we refresh some people's minds in this room about what we've been through so far. First Wind is going to come over and build a wind turbine farm on Anahaki Momohomi. And so then the homesteaders and others have to come out and say, no, you're not. And so then first, because somebody out there, which you're our utility, somebody out there has made a deal with First Wind. They didn't even have, they wrote kind of an RFP, but it fit only First Wind. And so Molokai Ranch at that time said, no, we won't lease you any land. We'll talk to the community. Okay, so then finally the PUC and others had to step in and say, no, it probably wasn't kosher, blah, 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 blah. That's First Wind.
Yeah.
And so then First Wind gets to go do something, another sweetheart deal, over on Maui. So then we hear patter, because all of a sudden the governor parachutes in and says, no, Molokai Ranch, you're a foreign corporation. You will either lose all your land through a domain or you lease some land to a wind turbine. So then we get into the PEIS process the first time.
Yes.
And so then we all come to those meetings, we give them our mana'o, and we talk about how we don't want wind turbines on Molokai. And in fact, there's all these federal people, and I'm going, go home, they already picked. What are you supposed to be doing? Oh, we're supposed to be consulting to the state of Hawaii. Why? They picked wind. But why did they pick wind? Sweetheart deal. Okay, so then all of a sudden somebody gets to somebody and says, oh, that was a mistake. Let's start the PEIS all over again. And so all over again, we've done it. And now tonight we are talking to Miko, which is really Hiko. And so what are we talking about again? We don't want it. We don't want to be a part of the system. We don't want the wind turbines here. We are concerned about where it goes. We are very concerned about what's happening to our electricity. And we know that the IRP process does not focus on Molokai. We can focus on Molokai. So the IRP process is not going to solve our problem because the whole focus is on how to supply electricity to 80% of the state on Oahu. That's where they spend their time. And so we spend all our time coming to these meetings, time and time again. When does it stop? Because at that whole meeting, what did they talk about? The undersea cable. So we know that a deal's being made because who was the only contractor in the room? Pattern, who formed Hawaii Inter-Island Cable. Right. So then we got to say, who do we trust? I'm sorry, but I do not trust anybody in any utility. I do not trust anybody in government because we have been at this and said the same thing, and all we see is the process being snowed through and going around corners. The PLDC, I have a really strong suspicion that the energy is buried in that PLDC.
because then the government could do whatever they damn well please without doing any environmental or cultural review. All of it starts to make sense. It's a conspiracy from
in the energy business. This was a done deal from years ago. This, all of these public meetings are whitewash. The whole purpose of this is to finally shove it down our throats. You're going to take 17 square miles of Molokai and ruin it forever. You're going to ruin our aina, you're going to ruin our culture, and basically we're only 7,000 people and there's nothing we can do about it. The BOEM is another example. There's all of these things going on behind the scenes. Mark Glick is doing all this stuff, the Department of Energy director is doing all this stuff behind the scenes. Governor is talking with the Obama administration, setting up the funding. So that, and the Obama administration is looking at alternatives so that the environmental impacts can't be considered. All of this is being done behind our backs while we're being told, oh, we're taking notes. I have to tell you, the CA is widely known in the real world as the corporate advocate. And the community you've never stood up in this entire process for the people. It's always been what's good for Big Wind. Never once have you intervened on the side of the people of Hawaii and to try to keep their rates down. So this is all a huge flim-flam, and I think you need to take that home and stop trying to cover it up.
Okay.
Because you were all talking about years and years and years and years of working on this and collecting information for years and years and years. Did it ever occur to any of you that the technology might have changed just a tiny bit? Just a little bit.
That's why the RFP is, because of all the new technologies. All right, let me say just one thing to you. And you know, we'll take home whatever it is you want to take home and believe, whatever it is you want to believe. But I know that what we intended to do this evening, and I believe we have done it, what we intended to do was to take the comments of the community that came to this meeting with respect to what your priorities are for alternative resources, and what are those things that you feel strongly against. That's what we know. You have no reason to trust me, nobody knows me, but I'm telling you that that's the assignment and that's what we're doing. I see now that there are at least two people who have not spoken yet, and I would like to give you the opportunity to speak. Here's my dilemma. There's a third person who hasn't spoken. Here's my dilemma. I'm going to bring you up and I'm going to let you speak. That means that, with your permission, we're going to go a bit over time. I apologize to you for that, because I try not to go over time. But I also need to hear from people who have not yet spoken. Would you be willing to come to the front of the room at the microphone?
Very quick.
And then would you also be willing to identify yourself? And then I'm coming to this gentleman here, and then I'm coming to this woman, and then I'm going to close it up.
My name is Bill Leach. I'm one of the probably newest residents to the island, although I've been coming here since 1981. I have, in the last year since this issue of windmills came up, spoken to probably hundreds of people, and only recently have I spoken to a single person who seems to not support the windmills, but say, in their words, to give it a chance to hear what it would do for the island. And that became apparent when they said that they had received a phone call talking about all the wonderful things, the benefits to the island, such as opening the hotel on the West End and the movie theaters and a couple of restaurants and the golf course. There are only about 40 or 50 people in the room here, and I want to go on record as saying that It wouldn't matter, in my opinion, if you got all 7,000 people in this room, there would hardly be anyone who would support the windmills coming to this island for many of the reasons that have been spoken tonight. So I just wanted to add that to that. Thank you very much.
Aloha, my name is Kanoho Wailuku-Helm, and by the way, I wanted to say I think you do a fabulous job facilitating this. The organization that I represent is called Aloha Molokai. This is our petitions. I think there's about 2,200 signatures here. And those who signed opposed the wind turbines and the undersea cable coming to Molokai. We also have a sign up online as well. There must be another few thousand of signatures on there as well. This island is just very much opposed to the wind turbines coming here and the undersea cable. Just one more thing, just to keep it short, as far as solutions, last I checked, the same sun that shines upon this island, it shines upon Oahu as well. And I think they can create that 200 megawatts, 400, even more than that, on the island itself. Thank you.
Aloha, my name is Leilani Khan. And my question is, I understand you can't speak to the RFP process or the PEIS process, but in terms of the IRP process, you said your stated goal for this evening is to gather information from everyone and community input. So I'd like to know, with the information you've gathered from Molokai, what is really going to happen with this? And I'm guessing you've heard a resounding kind of a message. So I think the input has been crystal clear. So knowing that, how do you see this information going forward, and how do you intend to use it in the IRP process directly to make some difference for everyone having come forth tonight? Thank you.
Very strong consensus that wind is not wanted and that solar seems to be something that Molokai would support.
Decentralized.
And no cable.
No.
And decentralized power generation. Yeah. Gotcha. So what would you do with that mana'o that you have heard from this community today?
Well, personally, I think we're going to incorporate it into the action plan and the resource plan. That's what I believe will happen from the input that we get.
And you should know, by the way, that Lona'i had the same message. Decentralization, each island should be able to count on its own resources and against the wind. And so, I think the reason we go to each island that we have gone to, the reason we have these meetings is because it affects the planning. It gives weight to the planning. So, I'll never convince you that there is no conspiracy or that the decision has not yet been made, but in my experience, that's the process. The process is to hear from you, to give weight to the planning, and that's a process that we're participating in. Yes?
Yes.
Maha.
I agree.
Yes. Okay. Here's my dilemma. Okay, are you okay now? Now I have three people who have already spoken, and I can go for another 15 minutes if you're comfortable. If you say to me no, we are not going another 15 minutes, close it down. I will close it down. Are you willing to accept us going another 15 minutes? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All right. All those opposed.
Hearing none, we're going to go another 15 minutes. I'm going to start with you because you've been very good. I'm coming to this gentleman, and then I'm coming back to that woman and to you. That's true. Yes, I will.
Go ahead and bring the mic back.
I will.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, now Matt mentioned that the IR, information request, okay, that's going to come from our questions that we bring up or our comments that we bring up this evening, correct? Where did he go? I have a habit of doing that. The IR that he'll be bringing up, those will contain from those will come from our questions and comments from this evening, correct? No, that was Matt.
That was my
comment. Ah, see, you weren't listening. Okay, the IRs, the information requests, those will stem from our questions and comments, correct?
Oh, those are not issued by us. I think that was John Tamora's comment.
My comment was that what I bring and what our office brings back from these meetings will be reflected in information requests when it gets to the docketed matters.
Okay. I don't know. PF, I'm going to need you to check the tape on that one.
As a public utility commission through the consumer advocate.
Okay.
That's that path.
And Greg, you mentioned that there wasn't enough or any debate in your IRP, right?
Energy philosophy.
Okay. Well, I am going to submit my 31 pages of questions and comments that I gave to the PEIS. And this can be put on the website. And Greg, if you need me to email it to you, let me know. And this should stimulate some debate. Okay.
I'm Kimo McPherson. I've been here for ages. I disagree with anything you guys say, okay? And I'm gonna be nice about it. It's really a political move to snow the people over, you know? We already know that we're gonna pay for it. Whatever your ideas come up, to come into a community and ask for our information, when you give us so many pages to read in a few seconds, and to come up, we want to know what information you know. Actually, that's almost like the scoping meetings we had. You want to know what we know and what we don't know. And you want to know how ignorant we are on the subject. Well, you know what? You're looking at people that are so smart that we know that the electric companies are in trouble. They are going to fail. If we all put photovoltaic on our roof, there won't be any electric company, because we will be able to get the sun, and all the energy we have will be there. We don't have to pay no third party for the energy. So, what I'm saying is, let's get it on. Who's the guy we're gonna blame for insulting us? I think it's the governor. He's setting up all these doing business as. Actually, I don't have enough time in my life to listen to this guy said that. This guy, we just gathering information. Check with that department. But you know what? We can't give you anything, no guarantees, you know? But you know what? This is going to take effect maybe 20 years from now. We're going to be dead by then. So when do we get, for the money we're paying for electricity, when do we get the results? I don't see it.
Okay. This woman and this gentleman will be the last.
I won't go to the mic, just a quick thing. I just wanted
my question about what, how the information would be used from tonight.
Yes.
So I just wasn't sure what that meant. Does that mean we'll just say, here's what the people said?
Think about it as you are doing your action planning, isn't it?
Yeah.
It affects your action planning.
So does that mean your recommendation would be not to have wind or an undersea cable for Molokai?
You can't say.
Yeah, you can't.
It's where you're at. Let me check. Okay.
That would be an action.
Larry Toole again. I was asked to ask this question. Where is HECO this evening, since they are at the center of this discussion? I understand that they're the parent company and they are making decisions about Oahu. I also wanted to extend a welcome to the gentleman from the Consumer Advocate's Office. I'm delighted to see you here. I appreciate your participation. I have to tell you, frankly, after attending several rate hike hearings, I was beginning to think that you were, your office was an urban myth and that you didn't really exist, but I can see that you do. My approach is maybe a little different than some other people. I don't look to the staff as the people who are taking initiatives, whether I like them or not. The staff works for the politicians. If you have a complaint, take it to the politicians. That's at least my view. But what I would like to know, what I've heard from you and I've heard about your office is, well, our funding is limited, our staff is limited, our time is tight. You said this evening you had 5 days for something that was very complicated. So I think it was, I've asked the same question of the PUC members and I did get an answer. It would be good for everyone in the public to know, what do you need to be a more effective public advocate? Because quite frankly, in this state, we need a lion in your office. We need a dragon. We need somebody who can scare people. And you can only work with the resources you have. But I don't know where your resources come from, but if everyone knew where they come from and what you really need to do your job, I think we'd all be better off. So welcome, I think.
So Sharon, do you want to answer the question, where is HECO tonight, and why aren't they here?
I guess I'm here to represent
HECO. Yes.
Okay, so my commitment to you, like Matt said, is we'll take the comments back. I think it's already been stated that the comments will be posted on the IRP IE, so that's actually, IE stands for independent entity. It feels like it's falling. Okay, but I think you can hear me. I can project pretty well. So my commitment to you is that I will take back the key points and tell me if I have it right. No big wind on Molokai, no undersea cable connecting Oahu to Molokai, and you would prefer resources like distributed photovoltaic systems, and I think someone mentioned maybe biomass, like Kiabe wood being a source for a biomass plant potentially. Is that correct? Or so?
We have plenty of ideas.
So I think if I, you know, I mean, thank you for your input. I really do appreciate the time that you've taken through multiple processes. And yes, I guess they're kind of driven by different agencies. So I guess that's why you've had to go through the process multiple times. I'm here to represent the utility in this integrated resource planning process, and that is my commitment to you, is that I'll take back that message and share it with my peers at Hawaiian Electric Company. Matt will share it with his peers also. So that's our obligation, and that's something I can commit to the Molokai community and the people who are here tonight. Okay.
Thank you very much, Sharon. An honor to be able to facilitate this meeting. I thank you all for your very smart comments. I thank you also for hanging in there with us in this process. And I hope that things go well.